Hi everyone, welcome again to all of you. So now we are moving ahead with the AMA sessions, right? We have curated some list of questions for all of you, right? So this is my first question. My first question is for Bhavani. Bhavani, this is for use case of kubectl. Why do we use kubectl and what is the difference between Airflow and kubectl?
Okay. So kubectl is a command line tool that will enable you to, you know, orchestrate your Kubernetes cluster. You can create pods in there, you can create your services. It's a command line tool to do all of that. Whereas Airflow is a data orchestration or data workflow designing tool. It's completely different. It's just that Airflow employs kubectl to manage data using Kubernetes. So those two are completely different. There's no point in comparing and contrasting them. Airflow uses Kubernetes to distribute the task among the Kubernetes pods, whereas kubectl is a command line tool.
Thank you, Bhavani. My next question is for Ramya. Ramya, what type of threshold do we use in circuit breakers in a client server model?
All right. So the circuit breaker pattern will be working in this way. A service client should invoke a remote service via a proxy, that functions in a similar way to an electrical circuit breaker. So when the number of consecutive failures crosses a threshold, the circuit breaker trips, and for the duration of a time period, all attempts to invoke the remote service will fail immediately. So that is how it works. So after the timeout expires, the circuit breaker allows a limited number of test requests to pass through. So if those requests succeed, the circuit breaker resumes a normal operation. Otherwise, if there is a failure, the timeout period begins again. So the threshold here would be the predefined number of times the request should send in case of exceptions. Also, the next threshold would be the timeout value for each circuit breaker. So after the timeout expires, the circuit breaker allows a limited number of test requests to pass through again. So I would like to share a few examples as well. The implementation of circuit breaker pattern in Python, there's a PyBreaker library, and for Java, there's a JREC library. So I guess that summarizes the answer.
Thank you, Ramya. Next, I think I can answer that. We would need several training utterances for every intent to be classified correctly. Can we provide only limited training example or variation of training example generated? Okay, so I'll break this question into two parts. First of all, I'll answer the first, that can we provide only limited training examples? So whosoever has asked this question, I just want to add that this is advisable that whenever we are adding training intents in any of the training utterances in any of the intent, we should add at least 10 utterances to it, right? 10 is considered to be the ideal utterances. And for the next question, our variation of minimum 10 intents, I would say, minimum 10 utterances, I would say, and then moving on with our variations of training example generated. So no, the variations of training examples are not generated automatically in Dialogflow, but yeah, if you're moving ahead, like if you have added one utterance into your intent, I would always suggest that before entering the next utterance into your Dialogflow, just test whether that the example you are adding, whether the Dialogflow is able to trigger the particular intent for that example or not. If it is able to trigger the intent, then you don't need to add that training example. Or if it is not able to, then you should add that. So this is what I would take it. Next question is for Shweta and Sriranjani. The question is, what is the difference between sparse categorical cross entropy and categorical cross entropy?
Thank you, Shilpa, for the question and whoever asked the question in the audience.
We cannot hear you. I think you're on mute.
I'm so sorry. Are you able to hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you.
Oh, awesome. Thank you, Shilpa, and thank you for asking the question, whoever asked in the audience. I would like to take that question. So I'll go step by step. So cross entropy is a metric that we try to optimize for classification problems in machine learning. categorical cross entropy is used for multi-class classifications. And what it essentially means is that the classification can either be binary or multi-class. That means either you can have two classes, which are like, you know, yes or no, or maybe cat and dog, or maybe when you have more than two classes to classify your training example into, in the case of MNIST digit classifier. Now, the difference between sparse categorical cross entropy and categorical cross entropy is that the way you actually represent your target variables. So you can represent your target variables in terms of numbers. For example, the target variable in the case that we took for the MNIST digit classifier, so the target variables were from 0, 1, 2, 3, up to 9. So those were actually numbers and digits. But you can also represent them as one-hot encoded vectors. What do we mean by that is that for each label, you have a vector of 10 numbers, and the position decides which number basically it represents. So for example, for the zeroth training label, the vector would look like something that, you know, you have one at the zeroth position, and the rest of the other numbers in that particular vector are zero. Similarly, if say you want to understand what is that vector or the target label for say digit 9, say let's take digit 8. So what will happen is that vector will look like something wherein you have all the zeros, and only at the eighth position, eighth index of that vector, then the value would be 1. So those are called one-hot encoded vectors. And so when you have when you represent your target labels as one-hot encoded vectors, you use categorical cross entropy. But if you're representing your target variables as actual numbers, if you have your target variables represented as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and up to 9, this can also be like, you know, if you have a cat versus dog versus, say, ferret classifier, and you have three classes, and you have named like, you know, cat is 1 and dog is 2 and ferret is 3. So in that case, if you're representing the target variable that way, then you use the sparse categorical cross entropy. So that's just a difference in both these metrics. Thank you.
Thank you, Shweta. So the next question we have is for Vijay. Vijay, what is the advice you would give, like to give to anybody aspiring to get into AI field?
Sure. Thank you, Shweta. I would suggest that if you would like to start off, you should brush up on your math. Specifically, it would be statistics, linear algebra, and a little bit of calculus. Again, it's not necessary to know a lot of calculus, but some calculus would be helpful. And then I would suggest starting off with actually data science. So Coursera has some excellent specializations in data science, but you could also pick any of the other learning platforms and do a specialization in data science. And if possible, work on, an online open source project in data science. And then I would suggest doing Andrew's machine learning course on Coursera. It is a difficult course, but if you have brushed up on your math, it shouldn't be very difficult to do. And once you're done with that, and I'm hoping that along the way, you've also picked up some Python. If you've not already worked in Python, Python is really easy to learn as a programming language. And then I would strongly suggest that you do Andrew's deep learning specialization. There is also a fast AI course that you could select, but there's a lot of online learning material. And as you're doing the course and, you know, working through the assignments, really important that you actually pay for these courses and do the assignments that are given with the courses. Just watching lectures in a kind of passive mode does not help, in my opinion. So once you've completed these courses, then I would say jump into actually picking up some open source data sets that are out there. Kaggle is a great place to start off with something really simple and then work your way up. Of course, ImageNet has a lot of data that can be used as well. So pick one of those and start to work through some of these actual live examples, right? So, and that will give you a lot of confidence. And as you're doing that, you will find that you do need GPUs for the most part to actually run your code. And this is where you'll start to get familiar with initially probably Google Colab or Floyd Hub, and then later you could use Google Cloud Platform or AWS's free tier. And so it's really important that you get very familiar with cloud technology as well. So if you have this repertoire of skills, which is Python, data science, machine learning, and deep learning, then the next thing I would strongly suggest is actually subscribing to newsletters in this space or even LinkedIn groups in this space so that you can start to kind of watch out for interesting areas in which say deep learning or AI is being used. And that may motivate you to actually take up some of those examples or work through some of those things, because you might have a natural interest in, say, climate change, and somebody's working on that project. So it may be a, you know, interesting, motivating for you to kind of, you know, jump in and start to, you know, collaborate on something like that. And this, once you've gotten to this stage, then I'm sure anybody out there would be ready to hire you as a full-fledged AI specialist working in this space.
Thank you so much, Vijay. I think you have covered many aspects of it. I think every aspect of how one could get into it.
Thank you.
So my next question is to Bhavani. Bhavani, what is the difference between data flow and Airflow?
Data flow, I think, is a cloud, in-cloud solution provided by Google, and Airflow is completely open source. And because it's in-cloud, a lot of weightlifting has been handled by Google Technologies itself. And Airflow, since it's open source, you have to do it. And one reason to choose Airflow over Dataflow is that as companies with risk management and all, we don't want to be hooked to a particular cloud infrastructure. We might want to switch between AWS and GCP. There is some business sense to it. So that was one reason to choose Airflow over Dataflow. But if you don't want to do a lot of weightlifting, Dataflow is the way to go.
Thank you so much, Bhavani. So my next question is for Ramya. Ramya, can downtime be a barrier?
All right, thanks, Shilpa. So downtime cannot be considered as a barrier, because the downtime means your system is not at all available. The logical barriers or physical barriers I mentioned are actually set to give our system the time to fix the failure or fault. So just like the load balancer or, you know, the connection ports. So in load balancer, whenever the server is down, the outside system will never know that, you know, the server is down. It's because if a server is down, the load balancer will cover it for you. Another example is like the connection pools. So the implementation of connection pools itself includes the retries, the retry limit, and the wait time and all. So that also will act as a barrier. So the answer to the question is downtime cannot be considered as a barrier, and because at that time, our system wouldn't be available.
Thank you, Ramya. Next is up for, I think this is for Mia. Are there particular bag of words that need to be defined for sentiment analysis? Okay. So in Dialogflow, the data which we use or the API which we use for sentiment analysis is already trained API, right? So you don't need to have any bag of words for that. But yeah, if you tried that API and you find out that there are some things which are missing out of it, or there are some things which you want to add on, custom add on, so it's always advisable to add it on your part, which is you can use fulfillment for that always. You can make your own script, you can add that into fulfillment part, and that's how you can use your external APIs and your external code or external bag of words for that. So my next question is for Shweta and Sriranjani again. Why did we use only 128 neurons for ReLU function?
Thank you thank you, Shilpa, for asking the question. But I think I would like to take the question. So I think it's not necessary that it has to be only 128. It is actually a hyperparameter, which means that you can choose the number of neurons for each of the hidden layers. So we saw how we were adding the complexity of the neural network architecture from a shallow network to a deep network. So each of the layer, you can add, multiple different number of neurons. So that is totally dependent upon the architecture and, whomever is designing the architecture. Usually, the rule is that, you can... people use 2 power some number, so that is the basic thumb rule they follow. But apart from that, it is totally depending on the architecture and also how much data you have and what is the complexity of your system you would like to be and how much training is possible. So all these things decide the number of neurons in each layer. Yeah.
Yes, Shrivanshini, I completely agree to that, that it depends on our data, that what number of neurons we need to go with. So next up, my question is with Vijay again. Vijay, we noticed that you are a freelancer, right? So what did you transition to the gig economy?
So that's an interesting question. Thank you, Shilpa. So I did work in the corporate world for 15 years and then decided to jump into freelancing, right? And the three main reasons. One is that it gave me the flexibility to balance work with life. And it allowed me to work from home, not just during COVID, but work from home for several years now. And the third is that it's really interesting because I get to, I'm actually freelancing with TopTal, which is a very selective platform for freelancers, for developers, designers, product managers, and project managers. And it allows me to work with clients from around the world and teams from around the world. So currently, I have two clients. One is in the US, New York City, and the team is in Serbia, Bangladesh, Toronto, and South America. And so it's in four continents and in six countries. My other client is in South Africa with one of the team members who is actually Swedish and is in the Canary Islands. So just to kind of show that, it gives you an opportunity to work with a number of different clients from different nationalities. I just love working with people from such different backgrounds. I learn a lot from them. So to me, this made a lot of sense and continue to make a lot of sense. When it doesn't, appeal to me so much more, then I'll be able to switch back into the corporate life if I were to choose so.
That's so true, Vijay. Like, I cannot agree more that people like you are always welcome in the corporate world. So my next question is with Bhavani. Bhavani, what is the difference between Jenkins and Airflow?
Okay, I know where this doubt is coming from because I showed this training the data and then rebuilding your production data flow and all that. I'll tell you a very simple way to, grasp this thing. If your code changes, if your developer is changing your model or something is changing at the code level, you use Jenkins because your code needs to be rebuilt and then deployed in the production. What if the data changes? Right? Someone is entering a data in a form. How do you bring that data back into the ML model? So anytime a new entry comes into your database or any streaming system, then you need to incorporate that data into the pipeline. So Airflow deals with data, whereas Jenkins deals with code.
Thank you, Bhavani. It was like much clearer difference. Okay, so this question is from Eden. Can we use Dialogflow with machine learning model? So to whosoever has asked this question, I would just like to answer that Dialogflow is already a trained machine learning algorithm. It is using the machine learning algorithms at backend. The machine learning algorithms which Dialogflow is using are very, very powerful algorithms and they perform very well on any type of data around NLU and everything. So I don't think so we need to use it, but yes. If you feel like using them, if you feel like that you need to use some, it is not fulfilling your requirement in some way, then fulfillment are always there to for you. You can always use fulfillment and answer and make your script, use your model whatsoever you want to, and then give back answer to Dialogflow. That's how you can use your external machine learning models with Dialogflow with the help of fulfillment. And then you can have cloud functions and everything. Like when you have code in your hand or when you have access in your hand, you can do anything with it when you want it to, right? So I think I would end my Q&A here. Thank you all the speakers to answer those questions. Those were amazing answers and we have learned again a lot from you. So it is a pleasure to have you here on board. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.